In this Plus Photo Show episode 20 for Monday, April 2nd, 2012.
I think I'm supposed to do the show intro, aren't I?
Yes.
But he just did it. This is very confusing.
Happy birthday.
It's my birthday. And then we brought cupcakes.
Yeah, the virtual kind.
Cupcakes.
Obviously, he's awfully quiet.
I'm just soaking it all in. He's been offended already.
Who?
Well, that was before I got to the hangout.
Oh, okay. There we go.
So that was your intro, Ollie?
Yeah, that's it. That's what he's got.
It's not even an intro. It's the show without an intro.
We're not going to introduce the show. We're not going to introduce the people. We're just going to dive right in.
Yeah, that's the way it goes. Around here, we all know everything.
Dive right in.
Oh my goodness.
It's the birthday boy. Special. He gets to drive the show the way he wants.
And we're taking the ship to Cuba.
That would be awesome. We should do a hangout in Cuba.
That would be interesting.
They spoke ganja.
What?
No, that's really? Jamaica.
Yeah, man.
The other country.
I don't want to get arrested in Cuba.
No, use the internet in Cuba, you might get arrested.
Yeah, this is true. You are using too many resources. It is
we
time
should
to
do a photo walk in Cuba, I mean.
No, it would be a photo run in Cuba.
If you want to keep your gear, that is.
But we don't have cigars.
Cuba imports cigars from him. I love that. That's my favorite, most interesting man commercial.
So it's been an interesting week.
Don't play with your polarizer.
So we are on the air, taping.
I was say, Ali.
Yeah, so how is your interesting week there, Ali? What's going on?
Well, I got to play with the Sony NEX-7.
Yeah, so did I.
Ooh. And so did Keith. Look at him smirking.
It's calling my name.
It's calling your name.
Yeah. In fact, I found out for $80,
question,
I can mount my 30.
Other than before we dive into how cool it was or
not cool. Not,
my buddy is planning on, as I've mentioned before, hiking from Mexico to Canada along the Pacific Crest Trail, which is the crest of the Cascades in the West Coast. And he's taking a Sony NEX-7. He's not a photographer, but he's trying to get the best content that he can. And do you think that it will hold up to 6 months?
How does he plan to charge the batteries?
He's got a solar panel, and he thinks that will charge.
I think we giggled about this last time, didn't we?
I don't know, but I'd like to know if it does.
He needs a Mr. Fusion, I think.
And what will he do with his
yes,
pictures?
Yes, he does need a Mr. Fusion. I cannot speak to that.
He needs to.
They're planning on doing a DVD, at least. I really tried to push him on the iPhone and maybe just use the old LifeProof case and enjoy the trail that way, because he's go light. He's actually having his tent and his backpack made, so because commercial products are too heavy.
Wow.
But I think tell me a little bit about this Sony NEX-7.
Well, I mean, in terms of the question that you asked, I think, you know, William got to spend a little bit more time, I think, playing with it in terms of durability. I mean, it'll look like in terms of usability, I mean, yeah, I think it'll hold up, but how's it going to react to water and dust and grime and all that? I mean, that I can't tell you. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't think anybody's tested it like that.
I mean, what I liked was the viewfinder, the optical viewfinder. That was pretty cool. Not so much for shooting, looking through it and composing, but when you look through it after you take the shot and you review the shot, and I have no idea how they do this, and I know Keith and William played with it as well, it looks like it's 3D. It really does.
Really?
Yeah, you look at it and you see depth there. That how in the world are they doing that? My guess is maybe the viewfinder is maybe parabolic or something, or got a little bit of a parabolic angle to it. but
well, it's a video display. So you're, when you're looking at it on the video on LCD on the back of the screen, it looks kind of flat. And as you said, it looks three-dimensional. You can tell depth when you look, when you hold it up to your eye. And that's kind of odd, but I'm wondering, you know, what the images are going to look like once you see them on screen or print them out, if they're going to have that same depth, or if they're going to suddenly look flat again. Maybe it's just an optical issue of why it looks that way when you're up to the eyepiece.
With that many megapixels, I don't think printing it's going to look bad.
It's 24 megapixels.
No, I mean, I don't think it'll look bad. I think what William was saying is we'll get the same amount of depth out of it. I don't know. I honestly don't know. But that was definitely something that was pretty impressive. It's still Micro Four Thirds. It's an APS-C sensor, so it means a $1,400 camera with a lens. I think the $1,100 with the with just the body.
And, but you didn't take a look at you didn't see the motions capture where it was unghosting all the people who walked by quickly. It has motion detect in it for people.
Right, when doing an auto exposure bracket for the HDR inside, you know, we'll do it out on JPEG, and we tested it out. You know, for people walking by, you wouldn't see any ghosting when it merged those in there. It would select people and put them in the right place, but yet the background itself looked, you know, had an HDR look to it. So they're somehow doing that kind of detection.
Wow.
Yeah, it was pretty cool.
It's not foolproof. I mean, we tried it with me waving my hand. If I'm waving it very fast, then you kind of see through my arm. But if I slow it down to the same pace of somebody walking down the mall that we were in, then it keeps it right where it is.
I wonder if that changes the rules of photojournalism. You know, we talked about this a little earlier in the shows, probably about show 14 or so, when the Washington, what was it, the Washington Journal, or was it the Post? Anyway, posted that HDR image, and they got a lot of backlash for it because it wasn't a single moment in time.
Right.
Nah.
I don't know, but I found out
it was the Post, and they did get a little bit of flack for it, but I don't know. It wasn't like, you know, they went crazy with it. It just, hey, you know what? We balanced the sky. They balanced the sky with, you know, right, let's say with the ground. But, I mean, if they had put a filter on there, you know, would anybody have made that much noise about it? I don't think so. So
I think that's kind of overstated. I mean, before digital came along, you know, somebody had to go in and make decisions when they were developing the film as to how it would come out. And that was manipulating it as post-processing. It had to happen. So why is it such a big deal now if they tweak the die, whereas they would have done it all the time in the past?
I thought it was a nifty little camera. And then I found out for $80, I can put an adapter ring on it and put my 35mm lenses on it. So.
Oh, cool.
Mm.
So
really?
Yeah. I mean, if I bought that camera, I'd have three lenses right off the bat for it.
Which is a good investment.
See, that makes it interesting to me, because that's been one of my big things about, you know, the Micro Four Thirds. It's like, are you really going to invest in a range of lenses for it? And then where are you going to go from there? You're kind of stuck. So I'd be curious to see how those adapter rings, you know, adapters will work.
The adapter rings, I'm curious if you lose a stop of light or half a stop or something like that. But Micro Four Thirds, or you know, going with a medium format, when you switch to a different type of camera system, you're going to switch to different kind of camera lenses. Even if I stay with a DSLR and I go from Nikon to Canon, I've lost the value of my lenses.
Well, but if you buy, let's say, a Rebel XTI, and then you upgrade to, I don't know, let's say a 5D3, and you can buy, you know, L lenses in the meantime, and you can still use those as you upgrade. That's not going to be the case if you get a Micro Four Thirds and then keep going. That's been one of my gripes. Right from the beginning, it's like, well, I'm going to get, you know, hemmed in, or I have to buy another set of lenses. And I just don't like that.
But those are within the same family. I mean, when you develop your photos, you know, digitally, do you convert them to DNG?
Well, yeah, but it's not about format. It's just about, you know.
It is about format. It's a format of a lens adapter.
Oh, come on. You know, that no.
That's not the same. Yeah. That's completely not the same. Nice yeah, try, exactly. But it's not at all close.
It you is. Are. If you go to linear DNG with a face camera and you try to use it on something else later on, it's
someone is wrong on the internet.
And the birthday boy says so, so
no,
it's true.
It can't be. Yeah.
Gold box deal of the day at Amazon.
The difference is that if you put an adapter on your L series lens so that it will fit on the next body, it doesn't. The shift of that lens is different, so you will not get the same quality no matter what you do. If you have an adapter in there, adapter ring, anything, either the depth of field will change, something will be modified. It will not be the same.
You lose all the electronic connection too.
Yeah.
Still though, I mean, in terms of a market segment, I mean, I get it. You know, and hey, yeah, you know what. You have an extra $1,500 and you want a really great small camera, extra. By all means. I think for most.
What about if you don't have any camera and you have no lens investment and you're looking at that for the first time?
Yeah, but then you have to think about it. You know, like, how do you want to grow? Do you want to, you know, how long are you going to keep this Micro Four Thirds before you start wishing, like, hey, you know what? Oh, I want a 14 to 24 millimeter, or I want a 300 millimeter or a 500 millimeter or wherever it is. You know, you're not necessarily going to be able to do that. So, right now, at least. But it was still interesting. I mean, I think, you know, I get the market, and some of those features were pretty cool.
I'm thinking it might be the camera I get.
What's interesting, I got a note yesterday actually from someone at Sony, and they were thinking of renaming from the Micro Four Thirds to 3/4. Because I guess there was a lot of confusion. There was a lot of people thinking that it was bigger than a full-frame sensor.
Right.
So they're thinking of renaming the Micro Four Thirds to Micro 3/4.
Why? I mean, if you look at it from a consumer's perspective, you know, most people don't understand DSLR, Micro Four Thirds, mirrorless camera. Why don't they just name it Ashton's camera, and then they'll sell a whole boatload of them?
People were writing in.
Put your cam.
Is this bigger than a full frame? You know, it's 4/3. Is that like 1 1/3? Or so Sony's just like, you know what? I think we're just going to go like Sony always does in their own direction.
They're going to bring about the wrath of the mathematicians that say 4/3 is not the same as 3/4.
Well, I don't know. I mean, of course, yesterday was April Fool's, so I mean, you can never trust anything you hear.
Yes, you can't trust anything yesterday.
Oh boy, that sounds like a backstory there.
Okay, so I had fun with you guys. I'm, you know, for my own amusement. Sorry.
Did you really?
Yeah, I did. I made that up.
All right, good deal.
it's bigger than a full frame.
It is bigger than a full frame. The 3/4 camera.
All respect that I had for you, Ali, just gone. Just like that, just gone.
See how quickly it goes.
Here I thought I could trust you. You take advantage of us.
Never trust a pirate.
Jesus. My goodness.
Oh my, oh my.
But I am innocent. Boris is awfully quiet.
I know.
I'm listening to you guys.
He's too busy playing with his neutral density filters.
No, I saw that camera yesterday. Some guy bought it in Adorama. Actually, he said he likes it better than Nikon for some reason or another. And it's 24 megapixels, am I right? I think.
Yes.
Yeah, he said, my friend Al, I think you met him, he said he wants to buy the Nikon 800. And he said, why do you need 36 megapixels? You can get 24 megapixels and basically the same quality of a picture. And I don't know. That's what the other argument in the store. So,
I didn't read it, but did anybody read that that comparison against the D800 and a large format camera? They were doing a comparison between the two.
Oh, cool. Did you see that? No. Do you have a link?
Yeah, I'm just pulling it up here. Give me 2 seconds. So it was F-stoppers, and they did this here. So there it is. Against a medium
F-stoppers.
Format. Yeah. So I'll post that in the chat too, just so that people can see what it is that we're talking about. But I'll
post it on the Plus.
There you go. So yeah, I haven't had a chance to read through it. I was just curious if anybody else had. So they were just sort of comparing the difference between the medium format and that.
I have not read it. Wow. Nope.
Did anybody use that camera yet?
What
camera?
The 800.
Sure. It's out there.
Yeah, no, I mean, anybody here played with it? I think that's what Trey had yesterday, right? Or Friday, Keith?
He didn't have it with him.
Some pictures with it.
He didn't have.
Did not sell that camera yet to customers. You have to be a NAP member to buy it first.
Really?
I don't know. Keith, you sat in on. Didn't you sit in on Trey's thing? Didn't Jarvey and a bunch of people already have it?
Yes, a bunch of them already have it. Trey's channel was delayed, but he's got it now. You know, he actually has had it for a couple of days, but it's been in his wife's possession. But I think he's physically got it now today.
I think the link you sent us, Joe, is in Spanish.
Is it?
Yeah, I was like, oh, go check out.
Come on, we're in Florida. We should be able to read that.
What are you talking about? Mine's in English.
English, but, like, it says. If you want to read the full article, head over to DSLR magazine. And you click on it, and it's in Espanol.
See, what they should have is Nikon versus... They should have the D800 versus the Leica S2. That's what I want to see.
Well, since nobody... Well,
there you go. I was just curious. That was what I was putting on. It was an interesting tag rate.
They're comparing the D800 with the Hasselblad H4D40, the Leica S2, and the Sigma D1.
There is an interesting issue with the 5D3 with a 200 millimeter dual IS, and this one's actually actually been confirmed. So there's basically some abnormal noise during IS when the shutter is pressed down halfway. So, and they're trying to figure out what they're going to do about it. But it's with the 200 F2 IS and the 800 5.6L IS. So that'll be interesting to see how they're going to sort it out. But I guess a couple people have run into it and Canon has confirmed it. So we'll figure it out.
That can't be good.
That's going to stop me from buying the 800 millimeter now, but oh well.
That's up to 0.8?
No, the 800 is a 5.6. I mean, I don't, that much glass?
That would be insane.
The price be alone.
So did you guys see the video that's going around, the Silver and Light Vimeo video about the guy that's doing glass... or not glass plate, but wet plate photography, basically. He built a camera that's a panel van.
No.
And he just opens up the back and exposes the...
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I saw that. It's
the plate.
That's... I don't know. Maybe it's not the same one, because I saw one that was similar to that, but it had a bellows and stuff that came out the back. Is that the same?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I saw that a while ago. Yeah, that's interesting.
The issue that I have is that they're dumping. They pull this thing up to Yosemite, and I have to watch it again because I don't want to be wrong on the internet. but they're pouring all these chemicals. You know, they're in hazmat suits basically, and pouring all the chemicals on the plate in Yosemite, and it's just like. National park, toxic chemicals.
Yeah.
Probably there's a reason why nobody does wet plate photography anymore.
I think they should go digital.
Maybe.
You know what I'm going to do? You know what I would do? Shoot the D800 and print on aluminum.
That would be interesting.
And expensive.
Yeah. Yeah, aluminum isn't all that isn't terribly expensive.
So do they have printers that print 36 megapixel pictures like this big?
I don't think you need a 36 megapixel print that big.
I mean, how much will it cost to print a poster picture?
How big do you want it? I don't know. I'm going to Bay Photo right now.
What's the biggest you can print?
Bay Photo? Are you listening?
Yeah.
As we yet again plug for a potential supporter of our
That's right.
Google Plus Hangout.
We have lots of potential.
Exactly.
So, all right, let's talk. I've brought this up a couple of times, and I keep seeing it. The death of Google Plus.
It's
a zombie product now. It was just like, oh my God, you just don't get it. And now I'm just like, I seriously turned the corner a couple weeks ago, and like I get more engagement on Facebook again than I
Google
do
Plus
on Google
is dead.
Plus.
It's a zombie product.
And, this is a zombie product.
Yeah.
Completely depends on what you're after. If you want it for, like, and this is my opinion, and take it for what it's worth, this is on the internet, so it could be true or it could be false, but I do get more interaction from clients on Facebook. It's just the nature of what I photograph as well. So, but then I have talked to a lot of photographers that are actually marketing and selling their prints via Google Plus. People are buying their stuff, and it's everything from landscape photographers to people who just have, you know, pretty pictures of flowers and different things like that, that people are just going to put on their bathroom walls. Like nothing that's a specific industry. It's just nice pictures, and they're selling prints using Google Plus and shipping all over North America. So I've heard both sides of it, and I guess it depends on who you have in your followings.
I think that Google Plus is just sort of like, I mean, I got more engagement in the beginning, you know, when it was small, and it's just kind of overwhelming now. I mean, you know, you post something and it's gone. There used to be like a 4-hour shelf life, you know, perishability to any sort of posts. And now it's just like, you know, I don't know.
If only you could have less followers there, Shane. If only you could have less followers.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. Could that just a factor of, or you know, because of the number of people that are following you at this point, or the number of people that you're following? Because, I mean, what I found is, you know, I have a following circle. And these are people that, I mean, I have a photographer circle. It's got, like, I don't know, a couple thousand people in it. And then I've got a following circle that's maybe like a couple hundred people in it.
Mm-hmm. Are we in that circle?
Yeah, actually, you know. And then I have, like a friend circle of people that are, you know, with just kind of the tight-knit group. So
are we in that circle?
I tend to look at those a lot more.
Thank you, Keith. I was
glad to be in that circle too. Yeah. Okay. Let me change it from all the blogs and everybody sort of, you know, wanting to predict the demise of Google Plus. And the blog that I read this week was, you know, what's the market for it? What's the use for it? Anyway, I run into photographers all the time when I teach workshops, and I run into workshop teachers as well, big names, and I talk Google Plus with everybody. And I've gotten maybe, I can count on one hand the number of people that have gone, oh yeah, oh cool, let me get on board with that.
What, with Google Plus?
Yeah.
That aren't currently using it.
Out of the dozens, you know, out of all the conversations that I've had with people that aren't on Google Plus, get on Google Plus. This is great. It's a great photography community. This is a great place. You know, there's not only, there's other photographers here that you can learn from and talk to, and or students that you can promote your workshops to. Yeah. And it really hasn't, everybody's like, you know, I don't get anybody, nobody gets any traction here, and they just leave. So my question to you guys is, have you talked to people out in the world and had them join Google Plus?
Yes.
I've asked, but I don't know if anybody would follow through on it.
Never brought it up.
I mean, I've had people, you know, like, hey, get on Google Plus. I mean, I can tell you my wife isn't on Google Plus. Like another social networks. Like I can't even keep up with Facebook. But what I found is Google Plus for me, and I think for a lot of folks, tends to be more engaging, but at a different, it's a different kind of conversation that I get on Facebook. Like a lot of times on Facebook, it's, oh, that's a great shot, or, you know, or like, you know, like Joe said, you know, here's, you know, I shot an engagement shoot, and, you know, everybody's on there, so they're sharing it, and the people's families are seeing it, and they're commenting, and so on. So, the conversation in terms of the level of conversation and engagement about, you know, like technical aspects happens more on Google Plus for me than it does on Facebook. Now, how much cross-pollinization you're going to get, I don't know. It is interesting that there's a Google Plus photographers page on Facebook now.
That's pretty active.
Yeah, it is.
Actually, I find active. Yeah, that reminds me of beginning days of Google Plus. That group over on Facebook.
It's a very small group of people who are very active.
Yep.
And I guess my point with all the circles and everything was that all those people over here on Google Plus are really hard to communicate with, but they're very easy to communicate with as a group over on Facebook because there's a group format for that.
Well, suppose Google enhances their page system so pages take off and you can actually run a business using Page as well. Do you think that would change
the game?
Well,
that's the other thing, too. I've consulted with a couple of businesses and gotten them on Google Plus, and they've abandoned. You know, they engage. They set up pages. They started doing Hangouts. They started doing everything that they needed to build a following, and then realized how clunky pages were and bailed.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's a lot of photographers here, but the businesses, there isn't a lot of businesses that are using Google Plus successfully.
Maybe that's a good thing. And what I mean by that is, you know, maybe it's kind of good to have sort of a smaller, group where you can actually reach some of the people that you normally wouldn't be able to reach on Facebook. I mean, it's just a kind of a different kind of conversation. Yeah, I know, you know, we all want to see it, you know, mushroom and be the leading social network, but right now, I mean, Facebook was first to market, and that's just how it is. And even today, you still have, I think the breakdown in terms of demographic is like 70% male on G Plus and 30% female, whereas Facebook kind of captured the mom market.
I think it's like 60-40.
Yeah,
I just checked that out.
It's the inverse of whatever Pinterest is.
Pinterest is like 90. They have their own network. Damn it!
Yeah. Now, suppose Google bought Pinterest.
No, come on.
Well, I just think, why aren't they supporting pages? Obviously, they don't care if businesses are here.
Well, they can't do everything all at once, you know? I mean, we are getting...
They can do everything at once.
Yeah, this is Google we're talking about. This is
Google.
I mean, hell, I just read a blog today where, you know, they're saying, oh, BlackBerry's done. How long is it before Apple is going to bite the bullet? Or bite the big one. I'm like, really? Apple? Die? Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Let's make that connection.
Yeah. I mean, it's interesting. I mean, there's certain blogs like Gizmodo. Every time they talk about Google Plus, it's like Google Plus is dead. The next year, it's like Google Plus has 50 million members, but Google Plus is dead.
Well, it depends on how you count those members. Remember, since they merged everything together, if you belong to any Google service, you belong to Google Plus. Yes. So you're a member whether you use it or not.
Mm. I mean, but that was before they merged everything, though. I mean, the whole merging was kind of recent.
A lot of people probably signed on to check it out, see if they liked it or not. That doesn't mean that they're using it or not, though. And if they do the numbers again now, like I said, once they've merged everything, yeah, well, everybody's Google Plus user if you got an account on Google.
I saw all of the same thing when Facebook came out and took the audience from MySpace.
You know, it's like there was Wave, there was Buzz. You know, I didn't exactly have high hopes for Google to have yet another social media experiment. This one's worked out better than anything else they've done. But
are we doing this show on Facebook next week? Is that what you guys are telling me?
The only thing that Facebook didn't steal from Google Plus, sorry, Mark, but you did, was Hangouts.
Give them time.
Well, they have Skype, but.
Yeah. And maybe they just don't have the architecture. Maybe they need to talk to you, Keith.
You can watch us on Facebook on the Vidcast Network page. There's an embedded live video box there.
So. Oh, cool. That's pretty cool. Okay, so Bay Photo metal prints, a 16x20 is $65, and a up to 40x60, which is $500.
Wow, how many times can I print that picture? For yourself.
Smaller sizes are reasonable. 4x6, $11. 16x16, $41.
Nice.
You can get metal business cards, which I find interesting. That seems like an assassin tool.
Remember me.
Until you go through the airport detector.
I'm filing the edges of my business cards.
Do business with me. I draw blood.
Shane, ninja photographer.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. That would be awesome.
Yeah, not to keep this thing going, but, you know, just going back to this whole Google Plus thing and so just social networking in general, you know, at least for this is what I found. Google Plus is where I go to talk to other photographers. Reddit is where I go to drive traffic to my site. Same with Pinterest. And Facebook is where I go to talk to clients. So that's how it's been for me.
Yep. I hear you there.
There you go.
I hear you, brother.
Well, if anyone from Reddit is listening, which I doubt, Josh, what's crazy is you can't choose the photo that you want to appear in your thumbnail. So if you have a photo that, let's say, is hosted on Google or on Picasa, it will not scrape that photo. It always chooses one of my ads. So I know, William, you upload your photos directly to your WordPress blog, and then it'll grab them from there. But
right. Well, I don't use Reddit, but okay.
Yeah. No, with Reddit, it chooses the photo for you.
That's so what is the benefit of this Reddit? Because I've never used it, never seen it. Nobody in my circles uses it, except for you, apparently. So explain it to me.
So Reddit is kind of like, it's kind of like Dig. Are you familiar with Dig at all?
No.
Okay, so you post
another analogy.
Dig is dead.
Dig is, well, it's certainly lost a lot of its power.
Yep. But yeah, so kind of Reddit is sort of the Facebook to Dig's MySpace.
Well, Reddit's been around for a long time. I've been a long Reddit user.
Yep.
Okay. So what does it do for you?
So basically what it is, you know, it's sort of a social news site. You post a link, people comment on it, get promoted. They can vote it up or they can vote it down. And, you know, if it's pretty popular, it goes up in the charts and more people have access to or has more visibility. And Keith, you can add a little bit more since you're probably more up.
No, you're doing fine. It's just it's an older site, and so it has a different layout. But basically, that's it. It's all user submitted content from other sources, with the goal that you're supposed to be able to find content that you're interested in that's similar or that's very popular.
Let me give you an example. You know, my blog is not, you know, widely read. It's not, you know, a go-to site on the internet. However, you know, I posted right around the New Year's Eve, I posted a guide to how to photograph New Year's Eve fireworks on Reddit.
Mm-hmm.
2,000 hits in just like a couple of hours. That's how much traffic it drove to my site.
That's cool.
Yeah, your average photo that you post on Reddit gets somewhere 80 to 90, 100. You know, that's not too bad. So, it's pretty cool. I think it's a good traffic driver. Okay. Same with Pinterest. I'm never going to upload photos directly to Pinterest anymore. I'll just upload the link to my blog and let people go that way.
So is that different, or do they snatch your rights, like vampire, like internet vampires?
No, they don't snatch your rights at all.
I know. I'm just furthering the
Pinterest thing.
Yes.
Vampire me, Pinterest.
Yeah, well, I've never used the picture service of Reddit, so.
So how do you use it, Keith?
I just use it for the news.
So you're just a viewer.
Yeah, I haven't posted anything on it, but consumer. I have, except for links, but yeah. Lurker, okay. Predominantly.
Lurker.
on Pinterest?
No, on Reddit.
Random posts and comments on people's things. It's almost interesting. Anyway, okay.
You know what? In the end, go where the audience is.
This is true.
Well, the problem is the audience isn't in one spot. It's segmented. So well, you have to have presence in multiple environments.
Exactly. And that's what I'm saying. I have different kinds, you know, for each different service I have. I find that it, you know, benefits me in a specific way. So
that begs the question of how much is too much?
Is too much? Well, I think obviously you have to put in to get out, right? And like I would love to have more of a following on Instagram. Yes, I said it, but I don't, you know. So, and Tumblr is also tumbleweeds for me. So
tumbleweeds.
Yes, thank you. So it's kind of like you really have to really engage to get people to reciprocate. Okay. So yeah, there is too much. You can spread yourself too thin.
Mm-hmm. Well, we haven't talked about Posterous, you know, which was just bought by Twitter, incidentally. Mm-hmm. So I'm
actually playing with Posterous because I think because you can post directly to it from Google Plus, I'm going to be able to share a post on Google Plus, and it's going to automatically tweet and Facebook and all that other stuff without me doing it multiple times.
Oh, can you go from G Plus to Posterous?
You can go from anything to Posterous. It's all email driven.
Because I know, like back in November, December, you couldn't post from Posterous to Google Plus.
No, you can't go in that direction. But I can make Google. I can make Google Plus my starting. I can make Google Plus my starting point. Don't go everywhere else.
And then go everywhere else. I'd love to do that actually.
Yeah, I'm gonna post. I'm gonna post something on it soon.
Yeah, let me know. I think that would be great. I'll share that all.
It's working right now for Evernote.
Evernote?
Yeah.
I use SpringPad, but I do the whole getting things done. I don't know if you ever heard of that, but that's a whole other conversation.
Reddit is claiming that I'm a 2-year veteran. So I've been on it for 2 years, which I guess an internet universe is a lifetime.
Yeah, I don't know what I'm at. I just joined it recently. I was surprised. I mean, I think I joined right before I posted that New Year's Eve.
I was impressed that one of Sheldon's t-shirts on Big Bang Theory was the Reddit shirt. So. There are some people there that know what's going on.
Good deal.
But you were talking about using multiple services and spreading yourself too thin. In some ways, the way everything is heading, especially in purchases and selling, is spreading out so thin it's micropayments. You're not going to be able to get, you know, $10,000 from a single sale, but you can get $10,000 $1 sales.
You know? Right. Yeah, that's sort of the iTunes model.
Yeah, because that's where we're heading, with, you know, thousands of micropayments, sub-dollar payments, especially if they're automated, so they just occur.
So that's a good topic to discuss. Do you think in pricing prints, it would be better to go cheap and volume? Or expensive and limited editions?
Well, that's like going the difference between stock photography and specialized fine print, right? That's in a sense what the analogy you're drawing is.
It is, yeah, it's very similar.
So it's
iStock or, you know, not. But fine art is a market that photography is cracking.
I'm going to plug a book. It's not my book. I'm not really plugging here, but I think it kind of goes back to what we were just saying, is that, you know, how much is too much? I think you got to look at it as like a funnel, you know, and you have all these Pinterests and Reddits and, you know, Amazon and affiliates and all that. You want to be able to kind of be a resource for folks and then, you know, do your whole affiliate deals so that you have your income. But then that's not going to be your only income stream. You're going to have workshops and you're going to have selling fine art prints. All of those things are going to, you know, be your revenue streams. So you're diversifying.
Many irons in the fire.
Exactly.
Well, you know, Trey Ratcliff's got over 1 million followers on Google Plus. Imagine if every single one of those people just gave him a penny.
Mm-hmm. I would go for $1 instead of a penny, but yeah.
Well, I would be more likely to offer a penny than I would be to just offer $1
yeah.
myself. But I hear where you're going with it. It still would be worthwhile. I don't know. I have this conversation with a lot of people who are looking to break into photography. You know, they've got a medium-sized portfolio in place, and they're looking to find some genre to go into that they enjoy doing. And they're trying to find a way to be able to market themselves. And it's a conversation that even I have a hard time with, is trying to decide where's my time best served. Like, I come here to Google Plus for me. That's the way I look at it, where I use Facebook and my website and blog and so forth to really promote my business. Cause it just doesn't work for me here. So I don't know. Does that make sense?
Yeah, totally.
It does. I tried to create my Disney persona on Google Plus separate. From my regular one, just like I did on Twitter, to keep the brands and the traffic.
Does it have ears?
Does what have ears?
Your Disney persona?
Yeah, it does.
I saw one of the horses at the rodeo had a Mickey Mouse brand. So I'm guessing they're from your area.
I don't know. But my point was, it doesn't work well under Google Plus. Google Plus works better when it's you as a person, no matter what the individual pieces are.
And that's by design.
Your design.
Well, it's by design. I think that's why business.
Oh, by design. I thought you said my design.
I wish it was my design.
It's the internet. It's true.
I don't think that businesses work well here, and that's the reason why. I think one of the things that I try to tell people is, like, you want your business to do well on Google Plus, get your employees on Google Plus and start talking about yourself and what you do and what you're passionate about. That's how certain companies have done well.
Well, I think it can work for Google Plus if Google would invest and clean up and do the pages correctly, make it worthwhile for businesses to be there. I mean, it's not like they don't have the footprint or the audience or the subscriber base to do it. They just haven't, you know, set it up right.
Well, they haven't. Is the business going to go out and engage the individuals, or is the business going to say a presence and here's another place that you can follow us and see what we're doing?
I don't, and maybe that's part of the problem. They don't know. They haven't made a decision.
Make a decision.
So I want to plug a book really quick, and there's nothing for me to get out of this. So, but it's a book that I've been reading through. Because I think, like many photographers, you know, what I think is a pretty good shooter, not Bresson or anything like that, but I'm a good shooter. But what I want to know is, hey, how do I monetize this hobby, or how do I feed this addiction? How do I get a 5D Mark III?
These are all questions I've been asking myself.
Well, that's what we're really talking about here. But you know, there are resources out there. And one of them that I found to be helpful, and I'm just starting to read this book right now. It's called The Photographer's Market. And the author is, hold on. The author is Mary Burl. I'm going to screw up this name. Burslav Bostic. You can find it on Amazon. I'll post a link here. I'm not in the chat. So Keith, are you in the chat? If I post it in G+, can you?
I cannot go into the G+ chat without disturbing the broadcast.
Oh, okay.
I can don't disturb the broadcast.
Okay, cool. But
don't, you know, taunt the broadcast.
It has a list. it has a list of art fairs. It has a list of magazines. A list of photo contests, and it has advice on, you know, how to position yourself, where to do your micro stock, and all of that. Because at the end of the day, if you're just shooting and you're not running this as a business, it's not going to go anywhere. I mean, I look at so many good photos on G+. And I look at some photos, and I'm like, you know, these are pretty good. But, you know,
Photographer's Market has been around for a long time.
Exactly. Yeah. I mean, it's in its 34th edition. So if you haven't,
it comes out every year. It's been out. I've been reading it since.
Yeah. In fact, not only that, there's an artist market. There's a market book that comes out annually for almost all these individual professions.
Exactly. So yeah, it's a good book. Come up with a plan and get a direction and get going.
Only 19 copies left.
Mine says only 3 left.
Oh, yeah, I saw only 3.
See, that's our power.
You there sold you 16 go. Copies.
So we just Amazon sold
15 copies.
No, darn it! I should have posted it on my blog.
So your distribution center just has more copies than ours.
This is a great time to mention the donate button for the Vidcast Network.
That's right.
It's always a great time to mention the one.
Without Keith Barrett, there would be no Google Plus.
Click it. Click it again.
So wait, you look up my name on Wikipedia, and it says inventor of Google.
Yeah. On that note, as we start mentioning funds, Boris leaves.
This shit sucks.
He's going to charge me eventually.
He hasn't said much, so he must be very occupied by something.
Yeah, he is out of it.
He's pretty quiet.
Somebody wants an invite.
I don't know.
I posted it live. I posted the link, so it should be out there.
I don't know. There's been a few people who've been trying to join in through the Vidcast network, and I know that Keith's been trying to get people in, but unfortunately.
Well, somebody said that I forgot who it was. Somebody said they couldn't watch the Google Plus stream version of the show. So.
Oh really?
Yeah.
Google Plus is dead.
It is dead.
It's alive. Dead
to me.
That's alive.
Welcome back.
So yeah, Photographer's Market is an excellent resource, and then you get to decide how you're going to get the attention of photo editors that have been overwhelmed for years.
No one likes HDR. I'm doomed.
Oh boy.
That's true. That's very true.
Looks too fake.
You're fighting an uphill battle that everything's sliding downhill on.
You know, but that's okay. You know what? If you're not enjoying it, it doesn't matter. If you start shooting for a market,
yeah,
you really want to do it. You know,
I hear you.
You know, so
you have to shoot for a market.
Well, yeah, but if you start looking at a shot and you're composing it and you're going, well, this isn't going to sell.
You could make a market there.
Yeah, totally, man.
That's what I'm saying. Shoot what you like. Find the market.
Let the market find you.
Mm-hmm.
I shoot
what
I buy.
Oh, it doesn't work that way.
Let the market find you.
It can work that way.
Sure, it can.
You also have to know what that publication has shot in the last 2 or 3 years.
So maybe your market isn't a publication.
Exactly.
This is true.
Maybe you're more of a microstock person. Or, you know, again. You want that revenue stream, so.
Don't say that word. You can't say that word, even if it is your birthday.
Revenue stream?
No, microstock.
Microstock? It is.
Only notable.
So we have less than 15 minutes left, guys. Just letting you know.
Okay, whoa. Let's share.
That went by fast.
Boom. Wow. It was a show about nothing.
It seems that way. There was no structure to this at all.
I heard Ali.
No, we knew that from the beginning.
I heard Ali say the word Micro Four Thirds and like in the same sentence.
No, yeah. I said Micro Four Thirds stock. And, I just combined bad words in the show together.
He said he said the NEX 7 and like in the same
although
sentence.
Although I did query some graphic artists this week, and they purchase strictly from my stock.
There's Getty Images. There's a bunch of them that are out there that are decent.
Yeah, they don't buy from Getty. They were like, oh, Getty, it's too expensive.
Really?
So, don't tell them Getty owns iStock.
Right. They know. Yeah, they knew.
The funny thing of that is I have
the premium top shelf stock.
Yeah.
Anyway. You were going to say?
Nothing. It's not worth it. I just was going to say that I had some photographer friends that were on iStock, and their sales have been diminishing and decreasing, and their revenue from that has been decreasing alongside that. So they're giving them smaller and smaller margins for the images, and they're becoming very picky as to what they take. And because of that, a lot of them are jumping ship and moving to other stock companies.
Huh, yep. Where are they going?
Somerset has their own sites.
Yeah, that is true. Yeah, there is some of that going.
You know, he set up his Warbird images because he figures, why should I take a 20 or 30% cut from a stock agency when I can set up a site and market it directly to the people that want it? He's got a very strong niche market to work with, and he can sell it all himself and keep all the proceeds other than his website talk.
Or sure. You can go to Photo Shelter.
Ooh.
You know,
your own.
Let me ask you this. I mean, if you look at Photo Shelter, SmugMug, Zenfolio, all these sites for selling stuff, how many people are making a living selling it? Or are they putting something up hoping that somebody comes by to buy it?
Well, you have to market. If you're marketing yourself, then, you know, you have to market yourself. And you can't just go to Photo Shelter and expect that you're going to make sales.
Right.
Yeah, obviously. It's your store.
And some people do that. Marketing. Some people go in and they're the first ones to say that, you know, you're marketing yourself, but you're also taking all the profit, as opposed to, you know, a stock agency where you're only getting 20%. Is that 20% worth it? No. Will you make it up? Will they, you know, make it up in volume sales?
Nah.
I don't think so. Don't buy that one.
Let's share some images.
Let's share images.
Go, Boris. You've got it.
GoBoris.com.
See, look at that. I plugged you.
Yes.
I've known a lot of people that have left iStock.
This picture I took in JPEG, 2.8 f-stop.
2.8? I'm shocked.
And it was the red filter that I can't pronounce the name of it. And black and white. And I didn't do nothing to the picture except put a little contrast. And that's it.
It's cool. I like it.
It was a 100 macro lens on a Canon. Not the L one, because I couldn't afford it that time.
Colby Brown would be proud.
And this is another one. The same thing. F-stop 2.8. I forgot what ISO it was. That's Washington Square Park in New York City. And that's the guy. That was the bird.
That's cool.
Bird guy.
And if you look close enough, you can actually see me in the glasses over here somewhere. And I didn't do no Photoshop, just brought up the contrast.
Cool. I like that.
Nice.
A Beem mode 2.8 ISO was like 400, 600. And that was it.
Cool.
And that was my Sunday walk to Adorama. That's it.
Nice, Boris.
Thanks. And JPEG, too.
There you go, man. Simple, clean little files.
And they were like 4 or 5 megs each file.
Why are you shooting in JPEG?
I try something different.
I won't shoot in JPEG.
No, because I bought this filter and it told me you have to shoot it in black and white. So I set my camera in black and white. And that was it. And there was, I bought this used for like $11 to $12. And that's it. It has one little scratch on it, but I don't care. For $12, you cannot go wrong.
Cool.
You're also decreasing, what, 1 or 2 stops? Is that the red filter?
Yeah. Yes, that's why I brought my ISO to like 600, something like that. I forgot. It was, yeah, because when I was shooting with f-stop 100, 200, the pictures were a little darker. And it was the f-stop 2.8. It was a little darker. So I brought up ISO speed to 608, something around that. I forgot the name.
William, do you have more from your Disney photo wall?
I've got a different one pulled up here. Let me see if I can't share that out.
That'd be cool.
This will be, let's see. This will be Microsoft's Xbox Live servers. No, Now, did I share that or not?
Yep. Yeah. Cool.
How'd you get to Microsoft's Xbox Live servers?
Oh, anybody can get to them.
Yeah. I'm posting a bit of a rant on the blog tomorrow. I was one of their beta testers, and you know, had my gamer tag since Xbox Live, you know, was in beta, obviously. And
wow.
A couple of weeks ago, I hardly use the servers, maybe a couple times a year. I signed on, I couldn't connect, called up support. The guy said, "Well, download your profile." I did. My gamer tag was gone, and it just had my real full name out there. So after several weeks of going back and forth, I said, "Yeah, we can't do anything to change that." I'm thinking, "Oh, come on, man! It's an entry in a database. It's clerical." But you just can't fight City Hall or customer support.
We are sorry that we cannot help you.
So this old UNIVAC is apparently the era that they're operating in. For
I was going to say, you know, that they're really impressive servers.
Yes, well, hand cabled.
My gamer tag is Shane East.
Do you want to play a game?
Florida. Somebody wanted to grab that.
Well, that's what we thought too, you know. And it's like, for one thing, you know, everybody thought I was a rapper. I used to say there, like, my little tagline was, "I am not a rapper." you know, but they tell me that it's not in use anymore, but yet it can't be released for use. I'm thinking, what do you mean can't? It's a database entry. Mm-hmm. Get a secretary with permissions and she'll take care of it. So that's my blog post and rant for tomorrow. The reason why I like Apple. I'll do all my gaming now on the iPad.
Yes. Angry Birds in Space.
Yes.
An Infinity Blade.
And yeah. It's high as hell.
So my weekend has been all cowboys and cowgirls.
Yeah, man. You've had some great pictures.
Let's see if I can share one out. I've narrowed the 2,200 photos down to 50.
Wow.
50 folders.
And I've got to narrow that down even farther. Can we see it?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, he's pretty. Nice. I'm pretty sure is one of the honchos.
I like that shot. I saw that on Facebook.
Yeah, yeah, I like that shot as well. And it almost, it didn't get any stars in the first edit.
Really?
Yep, I passed it by. But it was really tough. It was really tough because I had to get. Not only did I have to shoot the event, but I really wanted to shoot around the event as well, you know. Oh. And it's a 2-hour rodeo, so I was really, really hopping around. And finally, I just stopped and decided to relax and just kind of zened out. And I wanted to just be in the moment, you know, and I got some cool shots that way as well, but.
Cool.
Rushing around and that was pretty crazy. Got to sit in some fire ants. That was enjoyable. I did, and yeah. I decided that I really hate telephoto.
You hate telephoto?
If it's not wide, yeah, I hate it.
Oh, no.
If it's not a wide angle shot, I don't like it.
I was the same way. But I change when you get 70 to 200 millimeter lens, with f/stop 2.8, you will look differently.
I've had one. I don't like it. I've had one since the beginning of time.
So how long has it been since you've used it?
I rarely use it. I used it this week for this thing, and I freaking hate it.
That's the way I feel about my 50, and I do that. And the only reason I do is because I never use it. Everybody I know has an absolutely amazing time with a 50 mil lens, and I just cannot use that lens, no matter what I do.
What, 50 millimeter?
Just a fixed 50 millimeter lens.
I have it. I love it. Sometimes I like it. You know, if I go shoot at nighttime,
mm-hmm.
f/1.4, I love it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's good. It's good, but I like it. But I won't choose that lens all the time.
I hear you. It's just like Shane here saying that he can't stand a telephoto because why?
I have no reason to use it.
You know what? Okay. It's your art, man. You go with the look and how you like to shoot, you know?
Yeah.
Back to Shane. I mean, I love my 70-200. I mean, typically I'm shooting this the 17-40s of what I'm typically running around with. But every time I put the 70-200 on there, it's like, oh man, I remember why I love this lens.
I mean, you will get some muscles in your hand carrying it, but it's an awesome lens, especially when you go to the parks to take pictures of people. It's great.
It's not subtle, but it's great.
It's great. You need a tripod for that thing, and you'll be okay. Guys, not click on the link.
Hey, Sean.
Click on the link I posted in the chat box.
All right, I gotta try and share something else out here now.
Since
you hate your telephoto. Let's go over there. All right, this shot.
Awesome. That's a great shot.
Wide angle.
200 millimeters.
Wow.
I hated it at 24. Yep. It was too coarse. I mean, you know, that's why I like, I mean, I like all of my lenses because every one of them does something great, but when you say you hate the wide angle, this still gives you a wide angle feel, but it's pulling those other trees together and you're getting that compression that I couldn't get using a 24-70 or the 14-24.
Completely.
So I don't know. As soon as I heard hate, I thought, no, you can't hate it, man. it's too nice to hate.
Love your lens. All right.
Yes. I do.
Love your lens. Give it names.
All right, birthday boy. Come on, man. Share something.
Let's see. Where should I start? Well, you know what? I'm going to start with a little daddy bragging. Hold on. I can't help it. I think this is cute, and especially since Boris just shared his his shot of the guy being reflected back. So hold on. I'm just got to find my button here. How do you share on the slang?
You better share. Screen.
Oh, is that what you do? Here we go. All right. Where is Rich? Here we go. So
that's cool.
Yeah. So this was just like a very random, you know. Actually, I shot this with a wide angle, but you can actually see me. This is my son Jonah. Yep. You can see me in his eyes, which is why I love it. but other than this one, we had over the weekend. Trey Ratcliff was in town, and Keith was hosting him and taking him here and there. And we all went out to Disney. Myself and William was there, and Gilmar and a few other folks. And I'm trying to get to the actual shot I want to share.
Yes, can you bring a tripod to Disney?
Yes.
Yeah, you can.
So
this is I haven't spent a ton of time on HDR recently, but this one I think came out really well. I really like the shot a lot of the castle. And my little new trick is how to create a blue sky like that.
If you go look in my stream, there's a photo I posted of Trey working with the water management people.
Yeah, that was funny. So Trey wanted to create a water reflection, and he was corralling the water management people all around, and it was comical. And then the other shot was this one here of the fireworks from Fantasyland. So I actually went through. You see all the yellow here? I went through and hit that. That took a little bit of time.
What did you do?
What I wanted to do was I wanted a different look on the sky and on the on the fireworks. Let me just pull this up real quick. And I don't know if you can see the mask here, but it's pretty crazy.
Did you do that by hand?
I did that by hand, and then I inverted it for, one for the sky and one for the fireworks.
Why wouldn't you use like a masking software like On One's Mask Pro?
Yeah, but you know, and I'm not quite sure how well that would have done. What I wanted to do, though, I really wanted these edges here to be yellow. I did that by hand.
Wow.
But that's because I'm insane. You know.
Yeah, this is proving to be true.
I would have used refining.
Anyway, it was fun. It was a good time though. I really like.
It went off amazingly well for a photo walk that was planned literally in 120 minutes.
120 minute photo walk.
Yep.
He had the idea and posted the invite while we were in the car heading toward the Magic Kingdom.
Oh, that's funny. Yeah, because I was checking out Google Plus. I'm like, oh, yeah, I'll go. And luckily, I charged my batteries that day, so that worked out beautifully.
That was kind of the same way. And Keith, thanks for getting us in there.
No problem. Yeah, we tried to call out names of people that were local that we thought could go there with absolutely no notice.
People have nothing to do but read Google Plus on a Friday night.
That's me. I mean, like all I was going to do is watch Captain America, and I thought, that can wait.
Yeah, my wife is cool. She's like, yeah, go. Cool. That'll be fun.
Mm-hmm. That would be neat.
Sean, was that a 17 to 40 I just saw?
You've been found out, Sean.
Yeah. Oh, were you holding up? Maybe Shane was holding up a camera.
I had
it. Oh, Shane.
Okay. My bad.
17 to 50.
1750.
70 to
50. Cameron.
I love my 1740.
Sigma? Oh.
All right. We used to have Mr. Joe Pearson left. And,
we have.
And I know that.
We have. Yeah, we have about 5 minutes left. We have about 5 minutes left
for the recording. Cool. Well, I'll try to be quicker. You guys seeing that?
Yeah,
that's sweet.
That's sweet.
So I don't know if you guys celebrate this or not, but there's like that Earth Hour thing that happened this past weekend. Do you guys know about that? Hear about it?
I know about it. My lights were on.
Pretty much the deal of it. Pretty much the deal is that you're supposed to turn off as much hydro as you can for that 1 hour period, trying to conserve energy. And celebration of the Earth or whatever. Yeah. So
well, no one else
anyway,
is using
it. Yeah, exactly. That's when the best bandwidth is because everybody leaves and turns it all off.
I conserve energy by not driving.
Yeah, exactly. Anyway, so they at our city here, they have a big concert that they do, and for that hour they all go acoustic and they light it with LED lights and stuff like that, trying to make sure they're using as little power as possible. So anyway, these are just a couple of images of some of the bands and stuff that were up there. So just different people who are local to our area.
Did you use flash or anything like that to take these pictures?
No, just the available light that was being cast by what was on the stage.
Cool.
Yeah. And it was a little bit of a chilly night, so it was kind of neat because as they would breathe out, they would get this fog around them and stuff. So it was kind of cool.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. So anyway, just a couple of quick images.
Oh, I love that light coming down on his head.
Yeah, you know how many times it took me to try and get that?
Yeah.
I tried a lot of times trying to get that just so. So anyway, cool.
I have a crazy shot. Hold on. You just reminded me of the shot. And this is like a...
Ali's about to do some dumpster diving here.
Yep, and he's only got like a minute and a half to do it, too.
And you'll have to sign off the show, too.
Mm-hmm. There it is. With the laser beam coming out of the camera.
Lasers, man.
So you need CS6 so you can move that just that hair to the right so it's perfectly in line.
Yeah
I have CS6.
I've seen them before.
I really don't like the shot that much, honestly, but I just thought it was neat.
I've seen that before. That's Doctor Who saving the universe right now.
Yeah. It's like my shot. But there anyhow. Cool. All right, so show's over. Everybody go home.
Thanks so much. All
right. Happy birthday, man.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Hey, thanks, everybody.
Enjoy your cupcakes.
And that's our app. Are we doing an after show, Keith?
It's your decision.
I have to go back to work.
So just in the promotion of Google Plus, I'd like to say everybody follow everybody on G Plus so that it never dies. So we can make sure that Google will always be here for these wonderful hangouts, right?
Damn, I wanted to start a death to Google Plus movement.
Oh, you could, okay, do it.
All right.
Go ahead, Shane.
I have 30 seconds to do the ending credits here.
Death to Google Plus.
Bye-bye.
Bye.